Upadhibhi is significant. According to Jiva Goswami, Drishi means jnana, philosophical research. By different processes of philosophical research under different concepts, such as the process of Jnana Yoga, the same Bhagavan or the Supreme Personality of Godhead is understood as impersonal Brahman. Similarly, by the Eightfold Yoga system, he appears as the Paramatma. But in pure Krishna consciousness or knowledge in purity, when one tries to understand the Supreme Absolute Truth, one realizes him as the Supreme Person. The transcendence is realized simply on the basis of knowledge. The words used here, Paramatmeshwara Puman, are all transcendental and they refer to Supersoul. Supersoul is also described as Purusha, but the word Bhagavan directly refers to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is full of six opulence, wealth, fame, strength, beauty, knowledge and renunciation. He is the Personality of Godhead in different spiritual skies. The various descriptions of Paramatma, Ishvara and Puman indicate that the expansions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead are unlimited. Ultimately, to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one has to accept Bhakti Yoga. By executing Jnana Yoga or Dhyana Yoga, one has to eventually approach the Bhakti Yoga platform, and then Paramatma, Ishvara, Puman, etc. are all clearly understood. It is recommended in the second canto of Srimad Bhagavatam that whether one is a devotee or fruitive actor or liberationist, if he is intelligent enough, he should engage himself with all seriousness in the process of devotional service. It is also explained that whatever one desires, which is obtainable by fruitive activities, even if one wants to be elevated to higher planets, can achieve simply by execution of devotional service. Since the Supreme Lord is full in six opulences, he can bestow any one of them upon the worshipper. The one Supreme Personality of Godhead reveals himself to different thinkers as the Supreme Person or Impersonal Brahman or Paramatma. Impersonalists merge into the Impersonal Brahman, but that is not achieved by worshipping the Impersonal Brahman. If one takes to devotional service and at the same time desires to merge into the existence of Supreme Lord, he can achieve that. If someone desires to at all to merge into the existence of Supreme, he has to execute devotional service. The devotee can see the Supreme Lord face to face, but the jnani, the empiric philosopher or yogi cannot. They cannot be elevated to the position of associates of the Lord. There is no evidence in the scriptures stating that by cultivating knowledge or by worshipping the impersonal Brahman, one can become a personal associate of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Nor by executing the yogic principles can one become an associate of the Supreme Godhead. Impersonal Brahman, being formless, is described as Adrishya because the impersonal effulgence of the Brahma Jyoti covers the face of the Supreme Lord. Some yogis see the four-handed Vishnu sitting within the heart, and therefore in their case also the Supreme Lord is invisible. Only for the devotees is the Lord visible. Here the statement Drishi Adibi is significant. Since the Supreme Personality of Godhead is both invisible and visible, there are different features of the Lord. The Paramatma feature and the Brahman feature are invisible, but Bhagavan feature is visible. In the Vishnu Purana, this fact is very nicely explained. The universal form of the Lord and the formless Brahman effulgence of the Lord being invisible are inferior features. The concept of the universal form is material and the concept of impersonal Brahman is spiritual. But the highest spiritual understanding is the Personality of Godhead. The Vishnu Purana states, Vishnu Brahma Swarupena Swayam Eva Vyastitihi. Brahman's real feature is Vishnu or the Supreme. Brahman is Vishnu. Swayam Eva, that is his personal feature. The supreme spiritual conception is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita, Yad Gatva Nanivartante Tad Dhamam Paramam Mama. That specific abode called Paramam Mama is the place from which once one attains it, one does not return to the miserable conditional life. Every place, every space and everything belongs to Vishnu. But when he personally lives in Tad Dhamma Paramam, his supreme abode, one has to make one's destination the supreme abode of the Lord. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Purport. The Supreme Personality of Godhead alone is complete transcendental knowledge, but according to different processes of understanding, he appears differently. Either as impersonal Brahman, as Paramatma, as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, or as the Purusha Avatara. We've all heard this example of three villagers. This was in those days when trains were very newly introduced. Not many had seen the trains, not many had traveled by the trains. Unlike today, where every one of us, practically everyone, has sometime or other traveled in train. So these villagers, they had heard about it. Somebody had told them that trains have been introduced. Like sometimes when something is newly introduced, people are newly, just like now, the big statue of Sardar Patel. So everyone is inquisitive to go and have a look, to be there. So these three villagers, they set out so that they can get a better understanding of what a train looks like. So one of them had some faint idea, some idea about what the train is. And when he heard the train approaching on the track from a distance and making the sound, chuk, 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 that engine sound, and a sharp beam of light falling on the tracks, it was something similar to what he had heard about the train. And he also wanted to be the first one to go back to the village, and you know, it's always good to be the first one, right? There is some rasa in that. I did it for the first time. So he went back, rushed back to the village, and naturally the villagers were quite inquisitive. How does the train look like? So he described, sharp beam of light and makes a sound like this and moves on a track. So the villagers were quite happy with the answer. And the second one was relatively more patient. He kept on moving towards the track, and actually he saw train not only making a sound like this, not only throwing a sharp beam of light on the tracks, actually they were engines, they were bogies, and they were all connected, they were moving, you know, between the bogies there was some connection, and each bogies were lit with some light, there were some passengers inside. So he was also quite clear that he has a better understanding of train, and he rushed back and gave his understanding of train to the villagers. And the third one kept moving and actually reached the station where the train came and halted. And there he could see further more details. He saw actually in the engine there's a driver, and he was busy putting the coal in the, you know, engine. And he saw the passengers, they're coming down the bogies with their luggage, and you know, some of them getting inside, some of them putting the luggage, there's a place to keep the luggage, this place, like that, whole lot of details. So he also came back and gave a description of what the train looks like. Now, is the person who was the first to rush back to the village wrong in his understanding of train? The answer is no, he is right. He also has some understanding of train. It actually makes a sound like this. It also throws a sharp beam of light on the tracks. It moves on the track. But it is not a complete understanding. The second one, was he wrong in his description of train? The answer is no, he was right. Whatever he observed, with all integrity, he explained. But again, it is a partial understanding of what the train is. So likewise, here this verse is mentioning the Supreme Lord appears differently. Just like the train appears differently. The three villagers, it appeared differently. It's just a matter of who knows the best. So the Supreme Lord appears differently, either as impersonal Brahman. Some people, by following a certain process, Prabhupada here in the purport explains different processes of philosophical research. Some people predominantly who are very You know, jnani ki nature, jnana yoga. Want to fathom, want to understand. Believe in God, but using predominantly jnana process, they come to the understanding that the Lord is impersonal Brahman. And there are some yogis who predominantly use the yogic process, the Ashtanga yoga process. Everything is yoga, but Ashtanga yoga, which is yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, sit in rigid posture, meditate on the Lord within the heart, they come to the understanding that Lord is present as Super Soul or Paramatma, the Paramatma feature of the Supreme Lord. They all are not wrong, but not necessarily have the complete understanding of the Supreme Absolute Truth. And Prabhupada mentions here in the purport that only by devotional service, bhakti yoga, only by surrendering to the Supreme Lord and engaging in His loving devotional service, starting with the tongue, starting with Shrunvata Swakatha Krishna, we can understand the Supreme Lord in complete as the Supreme Person, the Absolute Truth. In Vedic times, everyone had a very clear understanding about, predominantly, that the Lord is there and we have to serve Him. The goal of life is not to eat, drink, be merry, enjoy life. Who has seen the next life? That was not the philosophy by and large which people were practicing. Then we have heard about, Prabhupada mentions in his books about Charvak Muni. He had a philosophy. Muni means, you know, they speculate and come up with an understanding of what the world is. So he had a philosophy which mentioned that ultimately the goal of life is to enjoy. And he says, because we have to enjoy, eat lot of ghee. Ghritam pribet. Rinam kritva ghritam pribet. Means, now where you get ghee? Ghee is very expensive. Many of us know ghee is good cooking medium. We should have ghee. But then, pure ghee, it's very expensive. Not everyone can afford it. So he says, rinam kritva. You beg, borrow or steal. You get ghee and enjoy life. Eat nicely. Then comes the question, if beg, borrow and steal, won't you get caught? Won't you be accountable in case something goes wrong? He says, that you don't worry. Because ultimately the body has to become ash. There is no concept of soul, afterlife, God, somebody watching, pious, punya, papa, what if you get caught? Just eat, drink, be merry, enjoy life. Final goal is enjoyment. Hook or crook, enjoy. That is Charvak philosophy. And if you see, 99.9% of the people are, even so-called religious people are now, because the Vedic culture in that sense, the influence has declined. Again, for various reasons, Kali Yuga. So, a lot of people subscribe to this. They may even go to temples, but ultimately it is to enjoy. I am the enjoyer. You need some blessings. They may even undertake some kind of penances, austerities, vratas, do some charity. Maybe get up early in the morning. Today morning I was watching, you know, it's quite cold and everyone is with the just chadar, bare chest. It's an austerity, but they may not necessarily have a conception of, clear conception of God, understanding of what is the goal of life. Some material desires are there and they are willing to do some tapa, some austerity, some sacrifice. So that's Charvak philosophy. But in this understanding, the concept of God, the concept of soul, there's a higher purpose to human form of life is all missing. And it is very, in that sense, a devotee, when he sees this, that this is what, it can see that it's so foolish. Just like the example is given, when children, parents invariably take them, you know, to play somewhere outdoors. And if they go to a beach, sometimes, you know, you see the children get so fascinated by the beach, the water, and they start playing with the sand there. And at times they may even build huge sand dunes. They can make castles in the sand. Castles mean some kind of a fort, some kind of a huge, spending hours together by piling up sand and, you know, playing with it, making the windows, making the doors and different things. And finally, when it is made, huge thing, one child from one end of the castle will start digging out some mud from sand, the other person from the other side, and finally they both touch each other's hand, and, you know, they are so excited, and they're so, you know, it's like a big victory. They finally made it, and then they come and embrace each other, and, you know, they're so fascinated. They're practically so involved in building a castle, and the parents are sitting there and watching. Chalo khel rahe hain, acha hai. They're aware, you know, just engrossed in that activity. And then comes the ill-fated wave. You know, there's high tide and low tide. And then comes the wave. And with that wave, one wave comes, and all that what they have so painstakingly with hours and hours of tapasya they have made just gets blown away. And depends on how much tapasya they have done, how much effort they have put in, how much hard they have worked, to that extent they will start feeling sorry, to the extent that they'll start crying. And when they look at the parents smile at them, at their foolishness. Although there may be mixed feelings, they may sympathize, empathize also for the hard work, what they've done. But they knew what is going to happen, which is inevitable. They are making sand dunes, castle in the sand next to the beach. The water wave is going to come and smash the whole thing. Just a question of time. So although they may empathize with the child, feel sorry for what they have gone through, but they smile. You know, it is very childish. That sand dune was not supposed to be there like this. It was supposed to be washed away one day. So likewise, which the children cannot appreciate. So just like here it's given, different appears differently depending on how evolved spiritually a person is. He will see the foolishness. Just like here, people are investing a lot of time, and they all are actually, what we see as childish, what children are doing, most of the people, 99% of the people, 99.99% of the people are doing in this world. We are building castles with a lot of energy, time being invested. And not knowing, not having, and so involved, so involved in the exercise that we don't realize that one day we have to leave and go. It's temporary. But those who are seers of the truth, those who are self-realized, those who are God-realized, those who are on knowledge, this is the avidya shakti which covers the living entity. It's the energy of the Lord. And the symptom of when a person is engaged in devotional service, he gets the real knowledge. He is blessed with Divya Gyan. A natural outcome of that Divya Gyan will be this avidya shakti diminishes. the impact of avidya shakti comes down and the person starts vairagya, starts seeing the futility of working so hard for some material gains. This is one of the symptoms. Just like, you know, sometimes people are so passionate about achieving something which is very materialistic goals. And we as devotees, again, we are not pure devotees, but whatever little bit knowledge we have, at times we see the futility of it. So that's some indication that the avidya shakti is diminishing, and the symptom is some element of vairagya will set in. The futility of engaging in materialistic activities, materialistic goals. So this was Charvak Muni. And then, broadly speaking, there are people who are, you know, atheists. Charvak Muni's philosophy is atheistic philosophy. There is no God, there is no life after death. Don't you see that finally it is all bhasma? This body eventually has to become ash. That is the final end. So eat, drink, be merry, enjoy life. What is pleasing to you? But what about papa, punya, pious, sinful, accountability? Something is right, something is wrong. So according to his understanding, Charvak Muni, what is pleasing to you and your mind, your senses, that is pious. What is not pleasing to you, what is not enjoyable to you, what doesn't satisfy your senses, that is impious. Our shastras give different understanding of pious, impious. So it's a very dangerous philosophy, and actually, to some extent, just like we have this, just do it. Just do it. So these are all, so to say, shishyas of Charvak Muni. And then in the evolution of soul, in the spiritual evolution, so they are hardcore atheists who do not believe in God, do not believe in afterlife, do not believe in soul. And then there could be living entities who have faint idea about Supreme Lord, about soul, about life after death. And a large portion of the Vedas is addressed for such souls who are called Karmakandis. They believe in tapa, they believe in austerities, they believe in sacrifice, they believe in some rituals, but they are called Sakamis. They are full of material desires. Krishna also in the Bhagavad Gita talks about the four kinds of people who will surrender to me. Even surrender to Krishna, even going to God, full of material desires. One who is in need of wealth, one who is inquisitive, one who is in knowledge, and one who is in distress. So, they may even engage in pious activities, may engage in so-called religious activities, but ultimately the goal is how I can enjoy, how I can control mother material nature. Devi esha gunamai mama maya dhurattaya. How I can, you know, be happy in this material world. And majority of the people, although they may be religious, although may have understanding of God, but they do not have a conception that this world is dukkhalayam, it's a shashvatam. Ultimately, we have to strive for tapo devyam shudriyat brahma saukhyam tonantam. We have to strive for eternal happiness. That conception is not there. They may even approach God, they may even surrender to God for some material gains. There was once an experiment done how we all can get lost of the purpose. So there was a cage made, a box made, which had one door. And one rat was put in that box from that door, and after putting it in the box, the door was closed. And everyone likes freedom. Nobody wants to be bound, put in a cage. So moment the rat was put through the door in the box and the door was closed, the rat became quite jittery, quite uncomfortable, was running here, there in the box, trying to escape, trying to get out of the box. Everyone wants freedom. But it couldn't. So after some time, you know, slowly when you it's conditioning, you start getting used to the new environment. And then in that box, for the sake of experiment, they also made two livers. If you touch one liver, some food, very tasty food specifically, which is very tasty for that rat, will fall. And one day, accidentally, that liver was touched by the rat and food fell. So the rat was very happy. And there was another liver, which, if touched, the rat will get a mild electric shock. So accidentally again that liver was touched and it got a shock. Soon the rat figured out which liver to touch to get the food and which liver to touch to avoid getting a shock. Now animals also have some intelligence. They also have, you know, you block the way of the ant, it will figure out where there's a danger and it'll turn the way and all that. So they have a sense. So the rat figured out, if you touch this river, food will fall. If you touch this liver, you know, you'll get a shock. And for the sake of experiment, they started interchanging the liver. After the rat figured out this thing, if the rat touches the liver in which food was supposed to fall, if it touches, it gets a shock. And if it touches the liver in which earlier he was getting a shock, food fell. So the rat got completely bewildered. Which liver to touch to get, because it's hungry. Now which liver to touch to get the food? If it touches this one, suddenly shock gets. But still he's hungry, wants food. And then, you know, he's saying, okay, should I touch this? Food falls. And they kept on interchanging this livers. Which liver will throw food, which liver will give a shock. And while this was on, the cat was figuring out where to get food, where to get. They opened the door from backside of the cage. And for days together, the cat was busy figuring out where to get food. And the door was open from the backside. And the idea is, if the rat goes out of the cage, food is there for him everywhere. But it got caged and got busy in finding out where to get food, how to avoid pain, how to get pleasure, how to avoid pain, and forgot that I am in the box and that is the root cause of my problem. Ultimately, when I was outside, food was available. So what happens is, karmakandis, those who are engaged in so-called pious activities also, doing punya and avoiding papa, are like these rats. The goal becomes somehow to be in this material world and enjoy and avoid misery. To be happy, to search for happiness, which Krishna in this Gita says, it is dukhalayam, it's designed. Even a so-called pious man, even if we engaged in pious activities throughout our life, to enjoy the pious reactions, the reactions of those pious activities, we have to take birth in this material world. And even if we take good birth in a good country with all facilities, we are not absolved of, we are not free from Janma, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadi. Just like compared to third world countries in America, very prosperous, you know, opulence, prosperity, comforts, infrastructure, everything relative to third world countries, it's quite superior. But still, there is old age, there's death. Recently, there was a news, 3 children from an Indian family went to the US on vacation, just recently, about 15 days back. And they were staying in a house, and it caught fire, and 3 of them were burnt alive from Andhra. So US, lot of infrastructure, everything is well planned, but still, old age is there, diseases are there, death is there. So likewise, the Shastras are giving us an understanding that no doubt different processes are there, karma kanda, because everyone is not at that level to understand the highest thing. One person asked me, you know, it's very confusing. You all say God is one. Ultimately, all scriptures, all Jesus, Muhammad, they all are representatives of God. God is one. But why do other scriptures recommend killing of animals and you are saying become a vegetarian, don't eat animals? It's diametrically opposite, 180 degree different. One is saying eat, other person is saying don't eat. So I told him it is not true that other scriptures are recommending eating meat. Even our scriptures are recommending. The Vedas also are recommending. So he was shocked, you know, because he thought ke only maybe, you know, Islam religion or the Quran recommends all these things what we hear, Bakri and all that thing. Even the Vedas, they have a conception of, you know, sacrificing an animal. So it's quite interesting because why different processes are there, why somebody has an understanding God is not there, why somebody has an understanding God is impersonal Brahman, somebody has an understanding is Paramatma, somebody has an understanding is a supreme personality of Godhead. Because every one of us are at different levels of our spiritual understanding. On one end of the spectrum are complete aborigines, you know, cannibals, meat eaters, flesh eaters, human, you know, completely uncultured, barbaric, almost like animals. You can call them animals. And the other end of the spectrum are pure, pristine, you know, pure devotees of the Lord, completely self-realized souls. So now the Vedas, or for that matter, all the scriptures are trying to elevate, they say, different strokes for different folks. You cannot have one common books of mathematics for everyone in the school. Different levels of mathematics is taught depending on what class they are in. So likewise, different scriptures are there, different religions are there, all of them trying to achieve the same objective, to take the subject from one level of understanding to next higher level of understanding. Some of them may not even aim for giving them the highest thing because they are not ready for it. Just like a teacher in class 3rd, her aim is not to somehow make him a graduate, make him to pass the 3rd exam and the class exam and promote him to the 4th class. So even in the Vedas, when I explained to him, he was completely, you know, for the first time he said, I never knew this. Even many of us have heard about the Vedas that, you know, goat sacrifice is recommended. But in one of the conversation lecture I was hearing, what exactly is mentioned in the Vedas about the sacrifice of goat to Mother Kali? So we'll get a context of what is being recommended and why it is recommended. So first thing is, in the Vedas it is a fact, it is recommended that you can offer goat to Goddess Kali. The conditions are, first, you have to offer once in a month, and that's on Amavasya day. The second condition is, you can offer only animals like goat, not higher animals like buffalo or cow.
Third, when that offer, you have to offer it as a sacrifice to Kali, not simply cut it and eat it on Amavasya day. So there is an element of understanding, there is a higher power, ultimate understanding of offering. Fourth, the person who is desirous of eating flesh, he himself should slit the throat of the goat. He himself, not go to the market and buy Kali Prasadam from some butcher has done that sacrifice and buy that and eat it. So it is recommended the person who is desirous of eating should personally slit the throat of the goat. And while he is slitting the throat of the goat, he should see the goat eye to eye. It's recommended. Why? Because the person sees the pain which the goat is going through when the throat is slit. The pain, the agony. So the person sees, this is what I am giving to the other living entity just for to satisfy my taste bud. Sixth condition is it should be done in middle of a night so that when actually the goat wriggles in pain and makes those shrieking sounds, you know, it's people don't hear. Most of the people are sleeping because it's going to make sound. It's going to, you know, wriggle in pain. So in middle of a night, do this sacrifice. And last thing is, which all of us have heard about, while this throat is being slit, you have to chant this mantra, Mamsaha Khadatiti Mamsaha, which means, in this life, I am sacrificing you. Next life, you can sacrifice me and eat my flesh. Now imagine a person who is desirous of eating flesh, the Vedas is giving this injunction, yes, you can eat flesh, knowing that anyway they are going to do it. They are hell-bent on eating recklessly. Okay, do this sacrifice to goddess Kali and eat goat. And the conditions are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. If actually one diligently follows this conditions, he will know, what am I doing? For that little pleasure, for few minutes of that titillating my taste buds, should I do all this and risk my own life, next life, becoming a goat, getting killed? The idea is not to encourage, the idea is to somehow make him give up. So all this, like here Prabhupada also mentions, all the scriptures, in fact a person who is a devotee of the Lord, he'll not be fanatic, he'll respect even other religions also. Because all religions, all bona fide representatives of the Lord are doing the same thing. Different people are at different levels of their understanding. Some people, God does not exist. Some, for them, God is energy, some power. He is impersonal. He is formless. He is nameless. For some people, he is, super soul. So different people have different conceptions according to the knowledge, understanding what they have. And it may not be the highest understanding. Ultimately, human form of life is, that's why Krishna says, Bahunam janmanam ante gyanvan mam prapadyante. So we all are very, very fortunate by the mercy of Prabhupada and pure devotees. What we are discussing, what we are understanding, what we have able to fathom, Krishna, worshipping him, engaged in his devotional service, it's a very, very rare thing. Brahmanda Brahmite Konno Bhagyavan Jeev Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Beach. So if you see this 4 lakh spectrum, different people, even so-called pious people, so-called ethical people, so-called religious people, so-called people who are engaged in severe penances, austerities, vratas. We are very blessed that we are engaged in devotional service, chanting, hearing, reading Bhagavatam. And once we have that understanding, once we realize what is our good fortune, what Prabhupada has given us, naturally we'll feel very grateful. Sometimes, we can take for granted and feel, just take for granted and lose value for that thing. Once we realize what we are doing, why we are doing what we are doing. Ultimately, the goal is not to eat, drink, be merry, enjoy life. Sometimes we all can also get into a, start looking for peace, start looking for happiness. Ultimately, the goal is that we become pure, get rid of all our anarthas, all our selfish desires, aham, ameti, I, mine. Develop our love for God, purify ourselves, tapo divyam shudhyet, become completely pure, and then get qualified to go back to the original home, kingdom of God, back home, back to God. That is our ultimate goal. Just like the example I gave about the cats, the rat in that box. Most of the people in this world, even so-called religious, are trapped in that activity. Karma Kanda is all about how to be happy in this world. How to avoid sinful activities whereby we have to suffer in this world. So how to avoid that and get good reactions. So with this, we'll stop. Anyone has any question, anything like to ask? Granth Raj, Srimad Bhagavatam ki Srila Prabhupada.